a great song, Joy in the House of the Lord. Yeah, there's joy coming back to life. I love it, and I believe that God is doing some incredible things. Last week, what an exciting gathering we had. In both gatherings, we baptized one person, but two people overall were baptized. New life, right? Lives being brought back, people being brought back to life in Jesus. And I don't know about you, but I was pumped by that. We came out of that and we had a meeting on Monday morning with the pastors, and we're like, you know, let's put together just an idea of how many people we would love to see baptized in this coming year. And it is just a number, but you know, the reality is you gotta set some goals, right? And so we would love to see over the next 12 months, a total of 25 people baptized. Would that be awesome?
Yeah.
You know, we've got to do this together, right? It is about telling the story of Jesus. It's about telling the story of a God who very much is interested in bringing people back to life in Jesus. One of the things I love about Celebrate Recovery, which is what we were talking about last week and celebrating that and how instrumental it is, how powerful it is. But one of the things I love about Celebrate Recovery is the fact that you can take off the mask. You can come and be a part of that gathering. It's every Friday night at 6:30, and you can take the mask off. You don't have to pretend like you have it all together. You don't have to pretend like you've got all your ducks in a row. You can come, and you will not be judged. You can step into this place and be loved and be an experience and encounter a life-changing presence of Jesus. But what I like about that, what I really like about that is that it's a great model for church. That shouldn't be just something that happens on Friday nights at 6:30. That should be the way the church always operates. Because just like, you know, you don't have to be afraid of being judged. You don't have to be afraid of being found out. Because guess what? The truth is, we have all been found out. And what God found didn't stop God from loving us with an unconditional love. And when you get to that point, you realize that faith in Jesus isn't about putting on a goody-goody fake face. That's what I like to call it. A goody-goody fake mask. The I've got all my stuff together kind of thing. No. See, faith in Jesus is recognizing there is no power within me that can carry this load alone of being in a world so broken and hurting. Did you hear me?
Yes.
Faith in Jesus is recognizing there is no power within me that can carry this load alone of being in a world so broken and hurting. We were not meant to live wearing masks. See, the very first humans, Adam and Eve, the very first humans who God breathed life into and had such an incredible relationship with them, you know, they didn't want to wear a mask until sin entered the scene. And when sin entered, then they suddenly realized that they were naked and ashamed. See, we weren't meant to wear masks. It's because of sin and shame. And I would go even so far as to say that masks are what is killing us. The mask gives us a false sense that as long as we are hiding behind the mask will hold it all together. Am I right? So we put our faith not in God, but we put our faith in the mask. Wouldn't it be great if we didn't feel the need to wear masks? Wouldn't it feel great? I just got that. You would not believe that. Anyway, that's pretty good. Wouldn't it be great if something could come along and exchange the guilt and all the shame underneath our mask and give us something new? throughout this series, we've been talking about how Jesus not only came back to life on Easter Sunday, but also what it means to live again in Jesus. See, what was brought back to life because of Jesus' resurrection. See, when we put our faith in Jesus, it is Jesus who is brought back to life in us. See, our old life is behind us, and we have a new life in Jesus. We no longer need the mask because there is nothing to hide. Woo. Yes. We can have a new life, one that is defined by Jesus Christ. It is a new life in Jesus. The week before last, before we did the Celebrate Recovery celebration, we talked about a guy named Philip who baptized a man from Ethiopia, quite possibly one of the very first people outside of the Jewish faith to be baptized into the faith of Jesus Christ. That was in Acts chapter 8 in the New Testament. When this man who had experienced so much in his life, right? On one hand, he had wealth and some sort of power, and yet he experienced humiliation of being a eunuch. Castrated at probably a very young age, of being an outsider. The man had such a powerful experience through the words of the prophet Isaiah, and with the help of this man, Philip, the man puts his faith in Jesus because he identifies with the one who identifies with him. And we don't know much what happened from that point on, but we do know that Philip goes on to share the good news of Jesus in other places. And some of the earliest Christian communities in the world, in history, actually can be found in Ethiopia, in Africa. And the early Christian faith began to spread rapidly throughout the ancient world. And one of the main catalysts behind this spread, this rapid spreading, was because the church was experiencing persecution. A few weeks ago, we talked about a man named Stephen who had been stoned to death because he talked about Jesus, right? See, people were actually being thrown in jail. People were actually being stoned to death. And for their safety, they would move around. They would leave their homes to go to other places where they weren't threatened to have their lives taken. And it wasn't necessarily because they were identified as Christians. See, the term Christian early on did not exist. They were seen by the Jewish religious leaders as a rogue sect of Judaism. They were teaching this new kind of stuff. They were talking about living certain ways. They were talking about having faith in this Jesus guy, right? And they were talking about a Messiah, a king who was sent by God, who wasn't there to overthrow Rome, but who would actually willingly lay down his life, listen, to overthrow the rule of sin and evil and death. And then this new Jewish sect that they saw claimed that this same king, after he died, came back to life and somehow became one with the God they'd always known. And now they're saying that the God they've always known, actually revealed Jesus. That somehow this Jesus is the God who has been at work all along. Minds are blown. Get the pitchfork and torches. But they can't stop it. In fact, we talked about this guy named Saul, who was really instrumental in trying to destroy the church early on. He was the one, when we talked about that guy, Stephen, Saul was the one who stood off and had gotten people all worked up and gotten the rumor mill started and got everybody really focused in and got the mob mentality going. He was a young Jewish religious leader who was on a fast track through the religious leadership program. These are my words, but this is what it really looked like. And he took it on himself to seek and find and destroy this new movement of Jesus followers. until he has an encounter, a spiritual encounter with this Jesus. And Saul spends some time wrestling with this encounter. See, you don't go from being incredibly passionate about destroying the Jesus movement to becoming a leader in the Jesus movement without some wrestling going on. And so Saul actually even has his name changed to Paul. And when Saul becomes Paul, he recognizes his experience is something unlike anything he had ever experienced before. Even as being as much of a religious guy as he was, this was something that was completely off the charts. And when Paul had the encounter with Jesus, it woke him up. It woke him up to the darkness that he had been walking around in. It woke him up to the suffering and pain he had caused the very God he claimed to love so much. Paul's actions, his violence towards those early followers of Jesus, his self-righteous, his soapbox approach didn't look anything like God's presence. And God shows him by showing him Jesus. Paul embraces his faith in Jesus. Paul sees it as a new life that he now has stepped into. He has left the old way of thinking behind, and now he is instrumental in bringing others with him, even those outside the Jewish faith, not by force, not by violence, but simply by sharing his incredible, remarkable, powerful story. His story as a person who was brought back to life in Jesus. Paul was a man with a new identity. He was a man with a new purpose. And so Paul brings this leadership to the church. We're going to look in Galatians. We're going to start off in Galatians in the New Testament of the Bible, in chapter 1 of Galatians, and then we're going to jump in a little bit here to chapter 2. But I want us to hear these words of Paul today in this letter that he wrote to the church in Galatia. All right, we're going to start in chapter 1, starting at verse 11 in Galatians. If you want to follow along, or you can follow along on the screen. Listen to these words that Paul shares. He says, "Dear brothers and sisters, I want you to understand that the gospel message I preach is not based on mere human reasoning. I received my message from no human source, and no one taught me. Instead, I received it by direct revelation from Jesus Christ. You know what I was like when I followed the Jewish religion, how I violently persecuted God's church. I did my best to destroy it." This is Paul describing it. "I was far ahead of my fellow Jews in my zeal for the traditions of my ancestors. But even before I was born, God chose me and called me by his marvelous grace.
Amen.
Then it pleased him to reveal his son to me so that I would proclaim the good news about Jesus to the Gentiles," which are everybody outside the Jewish faith, okay? "When this happened, I did not rush out to consult with any human being, nor did I go up to Jerusalem to consult with those who were apostles before I was. Instead," this is where he was wrestling with this, right? Going back and talking to this God that he had given his whole life to up until that point, right? He goes to Arabia, "and later I returned to the city of Damascus." There was some wrestling going on. So here's what they were dealing with, what's behind this letter. See, there's a situation where they have all this red tape they have to go through. They were trying to figure out, did people need to become part of the Jewish faith and then follow Jesus, right? Did they have to jump through all these hoops before the in crowd could decide they were one of them? What is the process? How does someone actually become part of this body of followers of Jesus? How does someone become part of this new movement, this new community? And really, they need to get to the heart of why does it all matter, right? What is the point of all of this? What is the point of Jesus? What is the point of having faith in Jesus? What is really different in our lives because of Jesus? That's really what they've got to get down to the heart of. It says, there has got to be more to faith in Jesus than just empty words. There has got to be more to faith in Jesus than just another organized religion. Because I'll tell you what, the world's got a, even back then, the world had a lot of organized religions. We don't just need another organized religion. So at the heart of what was unfolding was the birth of one organization within another. You had the Jewish faith. You had the law of Moses, right? Think of the Ten Commandments and all the rules and guidelines. The Ten Commandments plus several hundred other rules and guidelines. And you had this strong organizational piece of the Jewish religion. Then you had those early followers, those 11 disciples who become the 11 apostles, the 11 disciples who were the original folks around Jesus. Right? And we talked about this a few weeks ago. Those 11 then elected and gave responsibility to another 7, right? Because you had administration. This thing was growing and they got to keep up with people and they got to figure out all their discipleship processes and who's going to lead the music and who's going to do this. And you know how it is. It's church, right? Who is going to feed the hungry? Who was going to care for the marginalized? Who was going to help them do all the things that they needed to do? You have this rapid growth. And now, not just from Jewish people, but also people who are on the outside of the Jewish faith. Which I said earlier, those on the outside of the Jewish faith were called Gentiles, right? And it was getting a little out of hand. At least some would say. Too many people and not enough rule following, especially on the traditional view of things. And then on top of this, you had personalities. But would you believe that? We also have different personalities. You have different economic places that people are in. You have strong and extroverted and quiet and easygoing. You also have some of the heaviest, most rigid, religious crowd, some of them pushing really hard this idea that people had to convert to Judaism, which meant men had to be circumcised to prove that they really were adhering to the rules. And all the while, people like Paul, who once again, if you remember, was among the most rigid, most hardline type of people that you could imagine, saying, hang on, wait a minute. Of all the people who should be kept out of the community, of all the people who should not be allowed to have any kind of voice in the growth of this new movement, this new Jesus movement, it should be someone like him, Paul. Because look at what he has done. Look at all the hurt that he brought on so many people's lives. But here's what Paul says about that. Look at back at verse 15 and 16. He said, but even before I was born, God chose me and called me by his marvelous grace. Then it pleased him to reveal his son to me so that I would proclaim the good news about Jesus to the Gentiles. I love this. I love this reminder that every single person has a purpose. Every single person has been chosen to be in a relationship with the God of all creation. Amen. And when Paul encountered Jesus, the choice then becomes Paul's. What was he going to do with it? Paul surrendered to the love of Jesus that had been pursuing him. And then Paul sensed the call to take this message of Jesus even beyond the Jewish faith. It's a powerful story, and you would have thought that everyone could get on board with this. But now Paul has to drive this point home. As we said 2 weeks ago, there are no outsiders to Jesus. No outsiders to Jesus. But what he was dealing with was a religious culture that had been consumed with an us versus them kind of wall building, or the whole outsider versus insider mentality. It's difficult to see God in the light of Jesus as being one who says there's no outsiders to Jesus, right? It's difficult to see God in that light because for them, for many of them, that's not the kind of God they had constructed in their minds. That's not the kind of God they thought they knew. Paul has to help them to see what matters most to this God. And the tension over this mindset is so real. Even within this new movement, some of the leaders, particularly this man named Peter, who was an original follower of Jesus, right? One of the original disciples, struggled with this concept of living between the old way and the new life that Jesus offers. Listen to what Paul says. We're going to jump down to chapter 2 in Galatians and starting in verse 13. Listen to what Paul talks about, how he describes this encounter he has with Peter. He says, but when Peter came to Antioch, I had to oppose him to his face, for what he did was very wrong. He said, when Peter first arrived, he ate with the Gentile believers, those outside the Jewish faith, who were not circumcised. But afterward, when some friends of James came, these are some of the Jewish leaders from Jerusalem, Peter wouldn't eat with the Gentiles anymore. He was afraid of criticism from these people who insisted on the necessity of circumcision. As a result, other Jewish believers followed Peter's, and this is a strong word, Peter's hypocrisy. And even Barnabas was led astray by their hypocrisy. Paul goes on to say, when I saw that they were not following the truth of the gospel message, I said to Peter in front of all the others, since you, a Jew by birth, have discarded the Jewish laws and are living like a Gentile, why are you now trying to make these Gentiles follow the Jewish traditions? You and I are Jews by birth, not sinners like the Gentiles. Yet we know that a person is made right with God by faith in Jesus Christ, not by obeying the law. And we have believed in Christ Jesus so that we might be made, what's it say? Right with God because of our faith in Christ, not because we have obeyed the law. Listen here. For no one will ever be made right with God by obeying the law. But suppose, he says, we seek to be made right with God through faith in Christ, and then we are found guilty because we have abandoned the law. He's talking to these Jewish believers, like, who are so worried about all these rules and guidelines and all these hoops. He says, would that mean Christ has led us into sin? Absolutely not. Rather, I am a sinner if I rebuild the old system of law I already tore down. For when I tried to keep the law, it condemned me. Can never live up to it. So I died to the law. I stopped trying to meet all its requirements so that I might, say this with me, live for God. My old self has been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. So I live in this earthly body by trusting in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. Amen. I do not treat the grace of God as meaningless. For if keeping the law could make us right with God, then there was no need for Christ to die. It's interesting, this whole confrontation with Peter arises because mealtimes are really, really important, and they would oftentimes sit together with their different people groups, right? Insiders and outsiders, even insiders within the faith. And a lot of times they would regularly receive the Lord's Supper, which would even make it more strange that they had such an outsider and insider mentality. I remember when we lived in Nebraska, I would oftentimes get to go and have lunch with my kids at their elementary school. And it was the strangest thing, this setup that they had in the school system there. Everybody who brought their lunches to school sat at a table separate from everyone who had the school lunches. And my kids, they were into the bring your lunch to school things at that stage in life. They've changed, but I would go and I sit with them, and I would sit at this table where just a few of us would sit while so many kids were like over there. And I always thought that was so weird, and I felt weird. I felt strange sitting there thinking, why do we separate this so much? So I think about this. What was happening was a lot of mentality there from their old faith, from their old religion. It was being carried over into what was supposed to be their new life in Jesus. See, much of the old religion that they had become based on who was in and who was out. The rules and the guidelines became the center of their lives. And of course, you know what the best way is when you're trying to measure how good you are doing at following all the rules and guidelines are, right? You look and see how good other people are following the rules and guidelines. You follow me, or does that just sting? Are you there? Right? I mean, it's like, you know, let's take the Ten Commandments. You know, man, I wish I had that car that my neighbor has, but at least I'm not wanting to kill anybody. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
That's what was going on. See, the rules were meant to help them love God and love others, but instead, they became so obsessed with the rules that they really couldn't love anything. I'm gonna say that one more time. The rules were meant to help them love God and love others, but instead they became so obsessed with the rules that they really couldn't love anything.
God help us.
And Paul is saying, don't bring over the old ways to your new life. The new life Jesus has given you. He says in verse 18, rather, I am a sinner if I rebuild the old system of law I already tore down. For when I tried to keep the law, it condemned me. So I died to the law. I stopped trying to meet all the requirements so that I might live for God. My old self has been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. See, Paul is saying, stop trying to put on the masks. Stop trying to live a life measured by rules and guidelines. You want to know the best way to measure your life and how you're doing? Or better yet, you want to, you know, who to measure your life by? Measure it by Jesus. And I know you say, well, Aaron, Jesus was God. He was Mr. Perfect. You're right. But here's what Paul says. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. I recently met with this guy, young man, who has been struggling with some really horrible decisions he made about 3 or 4 years ago. Decisions that hurt some other people, and He reached out to them. He asked for forgiveness from them. He told them he was sorry, but he kept reliving it and reliving those moments, reliving the shame, reliving the guilt. And he'd been wrestling with this now for 3 or 4 years, right? And so I was talking to him, and so I got to this place, and he was broken up by it. And I said, well, tell me about your faith. He said, well, that's it. My faith, I believe that I can't wait to get to the afterlife. I can't wait to get to where I'm no longer in this life. Because maybe on the other side, I won't carry any more shame. I won't carry any more guilt. I just want to get to the other side as soon as possible. And so I said, well, let me tell you a little bit about my faith. My faith has a central part of it around this truth about forgiveness. It's a forgiveness that is so powerful, that does this deep healing in our lives, that we can actually have a new life in this life.
Amen. Amen.
That something can happen in our lives that can change us even now. See, that is what Paul is talking about here. That is what Jesus offers to us even today. Listen, when we are brought back to life, we can have a new life in Jesus now.
Amen.
A new life in Jesus now. We don't have to wait for it. It's not something that we have to wait until we die for. We can actually have a new life now that changes us now. And we can start living with a new hope because of a new life. We can start living free from the shame and the guilt because of the new life now. That is the power of Jesus's forgiveness. That is the power of the resurrection. And that is what he offers to us even in this moment in 2021. A hope that is based on a new life in Jesus now. That is what is offered to us. That is the story we tell. We can have a new life in this one. For some of us, it's time for us to start living for Jesus and not for a religion. For some of us, we need to exchange the guilt and the shame. For some of us, we need to have the courage to take the mask off and trust the healing, forgiving power of Jesus.